Knowledge. So today I'm going to talk about how to be able to integrate all these distributed energy resources in a way that would be economically efficient, but also it is going to be technically realizable or implementable. So I will start off actually outlining some of the basic new needs that the new grids are facing, and I'll talk about some of the possible ways forward that we are envisioning, and we'll talk about the more focused question of how to integrate a lot of these new distributed energy resources. And then I'll use an example of transactive energy management for a particular use case where there is excessive solar penetration on a distribution grid. So as we all know that there is increased penetration of solar resources and also the wind, which is creating a lot of ramping requirement that is needed. So in this figure, you can see that this is the California ISO duck curve, which is only increasing every year. The ramp requirement is increasing every year. And this is a sample plot of grid scale solar PV when a cloud passes at some time in the noon. And you can see how fast the fluctuations of the solar PV are. So this poses new operating problems in the sense that the operator is supposed to balance the supply and demand in near real time. And it also poses new market problems because the price incentives will have to be given for these fast responding generation or controllable demand to chase these fast fluctuations entering into the grid. So in today's methods, there is lack of proper software algorithms to actually accommodate all these new changes. And there are also no systematic market designs to actually accommodate these devices. So what we propose is to actually have a new kind of framework, which we refer to as Dynamic Monitoring and Decision Systems, DIMONS. So this is the future SCADA that we are envisioning. So today's SCADA is shown in orange here, where there is conventional generation resources and there is an operator. And generally, the operator is only interacting with the conventional resources at the high voltage part of the grid. And the communication with the substation, which is shown in purple here, is only one directional. And the communication down to the devices does not exist today. So today, to accommodate all these distributed energy resources and controllable demand, it is essential to actually model in detail what these individual devices can do at that particular spatial scale. So we propose to actually make use of some kind of intelligence embedded at each and every device, which we call as local DIMONS module, and actually facilitate some minimal information exchange with the coordinator in both the directions. So this is the DIMONS framework is basically more about having some kind of interactive information exchange between the devices and their coordinators at each and every temporal and spatial scales in the grid. So here the spatial complexity is evident, but one has to also consider the temporal complexity. So today there is estimations of the average demand that is supposed to be supplied, and there is only but on top of that, there is a lot of reserves that will have to be procured as well. And today, this is not being done in a transparent way. And actually, with this renewable integration, the amount of reserves that will have to be procured is actually going to be very significant. And the price tag has to be associated with respect to actually provision of these reserves. So the technical and economic signals should be such that these intricacies are accounted for. So what I mean by this is shown in this particular plot here, where there is a high voltage part of the grid which is actually having a lot of solar penetration here, that shows up as increased requirement to actually chase the fast supply-demand imbalance. So today it's being chased by what is known as automatic generation control, or AGC. So that results in increased wear and tear for the generators because they have to ramp up and down at very fast rates. But if we actually make use of an aggregate of demand side resources or the distribution grid through the Diamonds framework, it's possible to actually cut down on the fast, expensive generation that would be needed, which is shown in this green colored plot here. So this actually captures the value of fast, flexible end user response. But then the question here is how to actually manage the complexity of integrating a lot of these little devices here through some kind of aggregation, because the devices are in general very heterogeneous in nature. So to actually provide a solution to that, we have come up with a method. So the basic problem is that all these little devices, water heaters, electric vehicles, or the HVAC devices in the houses, actually they take as input electrical power, but the end use requirement is non-electrical in nature. So the problem is that these different energy domains makes the modeling and assuring provable grid, provable methods much more complex. So what we propose is to actually model all these devices using common energy-based modeling, where the specifications are in terms of this triplet, which we call energy, power, and rate of change of power over a specific time interval. So for operations, this triplet can be used as the interface specification. And for markets, the prices associated with these triplet can be used. And then modeling and control for actually integrating these prosumer devices becomes much more simpler. So an added advantage is that it's understood by engineers and economists alike. So here we can see the general framework. The idea is to actually embed a lot of these complicated decision making at the lower layer, which is actually driven by different kinds of consumption disturbances and the preferences of the consumers. And with an advanced control embedded here, it is possible to characterize what is known as generalized groups, which are quasi-static relations. And this is then used to actually produce the bids. So these bids are then submitted to the operator. And then after clearing, you get the dispatch signals with a price associated as well. And using the generalized group, that can be implemented as the set point for the respective quality of service variable. So with this framework, actually with complex control embedded at the individual decision makers, it's possible to characterize the flexibility through this quasi-static relation, where we homogenize the end-use requirements in terms of what is known as consumer comfort, and then it's possible to characterize the increments in the electrical power required to the energy use requirements of each and every device. So overall, at the system level, the information exchange through the Diamonds framework looks something like this, where the solid lines are corresponding to slower exchange, and the dotted lines correspond to faster unidirectional information exchange. So the coordinators receive information about the bids that are submitted by each and every prosumer device by the common energy-based modeling framework. And the prices and the load forecast is also received. And then the outputs of the coordinators are the energy and possibly other reserve signals that will have to be implemented by the devices. And then over these faster timescales, the reserve capacity that gets scheduled for actually gets implemented over a faster timescale just through unidirectional communication. So the common energy-based modeling framework and the system-level coordination through the Diamonds framework has been utilized to actually analyze what it means on this particular use case, where we have analyzed this IEEE 8500 standard grid, where there are several household devices, and in addition, there is a lot of solar penetration. So this was part of the NIST Transactive Energy Management Challenge, and we were part of the challenge as well. And so here the load is actually heterogeneous in nature, where there are different types of loads, and the patterns are shown here. Shown in yellow is actually the solar penetration, and at 15th hour there is this cloud passing by, which actually causes a sudden dip in the solar penetration. So we've analyzed all these four cases where there is a sunny day when there is no storm front, and then there is a second case where there is a stormy day and there is this sudden dip. And we have also analyzed from the economics perspective what it means for the devices to be actually paid using this time of use pricing versus the dynamic pricing. So there is a lot of information in the material that just got recently published, but I'll give just basic overview. So in the report you can find that we have actually quantified, we have actually qualitatively analyzed for each of these cases what is the role and the sub-objective of the different stakeholders in that particular grid. For houses, what are the objectives for when there is dynamic pricing versus when there is no pricing and there's just like a uniform tariff, and what it means for the distribution grid and market. So the details can be actually looked for in this report that just got recently published. But the major conclusions, I'll just elaborate here. So we have simulated these 8500 node system by using our simulation platform, which we call as Scalable Electrical Power System Simulator, where the software design has been based on the structure of the power grid. And we have actually simulated the interactions between the houses and the neighborhoods and the distribution system operator in here. And we have used an external ACOPF solver for actually implementing the functionality of the distribution system operator. And so what we have seen through the embedded decision making at the device level is that the water heaters and HVACs are less sensitive to voltage violations. So here in the two axes that you see here are the real and reactive power deviations, and on the Z axis is the voltage violation. And the solar PV or battery is like more sensitive to voltage violations. So with small adjustment in real or reactive power set points, it can actually control its own voltage. So, and then we've also used the decision making at the devices to create these kinds of bids, which are going to be very much dependent on how we model the comfort constraints, where if the future comfort constraints are relaxed, the bids will be more flexible in nature in general. And if they are not, it is going to be more horizontal. So this bidding is based on look ahead estimated market prices. And then, so from the utility perspective, we have seen that we've been able to actually make sure the voltages are within the limits for all the four cases that we considered. This is actually not true in today's operation of distribution system because it's only based on power flow analysis. But here we have optimized for the voltage profiles, both by clearing the bids and also by using the existing voltage control devices. And also by using the MPC-based decision making in the dynamic pricing case shown in dotted green here, we were able to reduce the ramping requirement from the utility generation standpoint. And also the voltage violation sensitivity in the case 4, which is the dynamic pricing version, has been reduced by some extent. And this actually contributes to lower prices. But then the downside is that the device level decision making may result in operation of voltage control devices more frequently in the dynamic pricing case. And the cumulative operation cost, we have seen that this green color corresponds to cumulative operation cost, which we have reduced by a large extent. So the major observation is that actually utility can play a major role, and it actually forms the basis for peak load pricing and or other performance-based regulations. So to conclude, so our approach was basically based on a minimally coordinated decision framework where a lot of uncertainty and the decision-making is embedded at the devices, and only minimal information is used for clearing at the system level. So we've also actually simplified the modeling framework to actually make this possible. And we've been working on developing a simulation platform, actually, which makes this platform more scalable. Yeah. Thank you.
I think we have time for one or two questions. And if we could hook up the next speaker as we do this, this would be great. I have a quick question.
Yeah.
When you were optimizing power, it was complex power?
Mm-hmm.
That's my question. So all this is done decentralized? There's no central optimization, central?
No, it's all distributed in nature, where there is a lot of look-ahead decision-making done at the component level, and just some minimal information is used at the clearing stage by the centralized operator, which is going to be an easier problem to solve.
And have you compared that to if you solve the problem to a single decision maker?
Firstly, it's not possible to solve that problem because the uncertainties cannot be considered by the central system operator at once, and it is more possible for the problem to be infeasible if it's all solved as a single flat layer. And secondly, it poses numerical challenges because of a large number of decision variables. And also from the market's perspective, we've compared actually for smaller systems when the system is, when the problem is going to be feasible. And we do see that you have like increased marginal clearing prices and so on and so forth. So we do believe that abstracting the uncertainties and so on at the individual decision makers is much more beneficial than centralized approach.
Any other questions?
Quick one related to that. So in your decentralized distributed algorithm, do you need to do iterations to converge, or is it like?
No. It's a one-shot approach. Actually, the theoretical details can be in. Explained in the paper if you're invited, but it's more based on functional bits, what we call. The reference to that is, I think, provided somewhere in here. So actually, if you the Diamonds framework relies on sensitivity bits, wherein you don't need to actually iterate upon the point-wise bits until convergence. Rather, you get a function which actually abstracts how the points vary with changes in prices. So some kind of price sensitivity